This guitar interactive feature is brought to you by EMG Pickups.
Hi guys, Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive Magazine here. Thanks for tuning in for this month's tech session. And the subject of our study for the day is Zakk Wylde. Probably, in my opinion, the most intense and exciting rock guitarist of a generation. And hopefully we're gonna kind of pick through the key parts of what makes Zakk tick. So we're looking at work inspired by his tenure with Ozzy Osbourne, both from the 1980s, 90s, and 2000s. We're looking at some black label kind of stuff, some of the heavier material, and also some of the balladeering, which gets often overlooked. There's a little bit of pride and glory stuff towards the end, and we've even got a little snip from the Rockstar soundtrack, which I'm not ashamed to say. So let's get cracking with the knacking. First thing I want to talk to you about is the way Zakk holds and uses a plectrum. Now, I'm sure it's probably not escaped your attention that Zakk is a quite phenomenal alternate picker. His technique's kind of unusual, but those of you who are kind of familiar with the Troy Grady parlance, and you really should be by now, it's important stuff. Zakk is a full-time downward pick slanter. And what that means, as far as we're concerned, is the two bones in his forearm, we have the radius and the ulna. The radius is this one that sort of moves. The radius is off the guitar's body, so it's kind of up there, whereas the ulna is kind of resting on the body of the guitar. And this has the effect of directing his pick strokes so that the down picks bury into the plane of the strings, and the up picks rise up from the plane of the strings, which enables us to change strings very, very easily on an up pick. There is, of course, also a method for changing strings after a down pick, which I shall talk to you about in a moment. But for the time being, it's enough to acknowledge that kind of hand position and kind of assume that as we go forward with this one. And I actually think this was born out of the way Zakk wears his guitar, which is immensely low and very, very rock and roll. Now, another thing to pay attention to with this one is Zakk is primarily an elbow picker. And there's nothing wrong with that, right? People will try and tell you that you must always use your wrist. It's not 100% true. There are great elbow pickers out there. You don't have to assume this elbow technique for the course of the tech session, but if you want to be authentically Zakk, elbow is the way. However, it is to be noted that he's not always hitting the guitar as hard as people think he is. On some of the faster runs, yes, Zakk's been very, very aggressive, but on the blooming, singing, sustained notes, it's actually more of a gentle brush, which allows the note to sustain and kind of bloom into kind of a big singing, soaring feedback. The way we achieve that is by relaxing this joint and this joint right here, so that when the pick makes contact with the strings, it's got a little bit of flexion, a little bit of give, and it sort of flops over the string rather than kind of battering through the string. Now you can tense this up and get this kind of battering effect on the faster runs, but try and relax it if you can on the more sustained kind of passages, and you'll notice the tone will improve drastically. Another thing to pay attention to, we will get into the meat of the session in a moment, but another thing to pay attention to is kind of the amount of finger and thumb skin that you're brushing the string with as you play. Zakk uses quite a lot of finger and thumb on the string. It's kind of a gentle graze. This is how he achieves those famous pinched harmonics, but it's also how we get that kind of meowing, almost cocked wah-like tone that kind of makes Zakk and other guys of that era so distinctive and so intense sounding. It also gives you a way of gauging the amount of depth that your pick is how deep your pick is going on the string, if you want to call it that. Very, very quickly, a quick note on that. I'm just going to turn my guitar up. I'm going to play with very little flesh on the string, and then I'll start to introduce a little more of that thumb and finger thing, and you'll see what I mean. So this is without. And if we start to brush with our thumb and forefinger, we get this kind of thing. So you can hear there's almost kind of like a subtle semi-harmonic kind of quality. This is a constant through Zakk's kind of lead guitar playing, and even on the riffs, and it sort of makes the notes kind of blossom and bloom with this kind of interesting harmonic content. So bear all of that stuff in mind as we go forward with this one. Now, let's get started with the intro. So the intro to this piece is basically just a noise. I've got my univibe on, we switched over to the neck pickup. We're playing the E string on fret 17, and then the B string on fret number 21, and we're using some fairly gentle vibrato for Zakk. It would probably constitute a wide vibrato for everybody else, but it's fairly gentle for Zakk's standards, to kind of create a clash between this note here and this note here. Now, what we've got kind of there is we've got an A natural, and we've got an A flat, so they should clash anyway, but as you vibrato this note, it'll start to create this kind of crackling sort of sound. I'll just turn the vibe off for now. We get this sort of thing. And if we kick the vibe on, it kind of exaggerates that even further. Now, Zakk uses a Dunlop rotor vibe, but for our purposes, any kind of wobbly phaser or chorus will do. And it sounds like this. Now, moving swiftly on into our first riff. This is inspired by Zakk's work in the early 2000s with Ozzy, specifically the Down to Earth album. And it sounds a little bit like this. So if you've checked out the tab for this one, you'll know that we're in drop D, which means that our low E string is tuned down to a D note, it's a whole tone down. And we have D, A, D, which enables us to play one-fingered power chords. I'll play through this one slowly for you, and it sounds like this. Now, a quick note on the pinched harmonics there. To really make these pop out, you've got to ease up your pick attack and let the thumb and forefinger brush the string ever so gently. Experiment with whereabouts you are on the string with this one as well. There's going to be a nice point which gets both notes screaming just nice. Now, another word on vibrato for this one. We'll get to that in more detail in a moment. But the vibrato that we're playing on these pinched harmonics is very wide. We're aiming for a moderate speed, but the intensity is coming from the sheer depth of the vibrato. And we're actually aiming for a 3-fret depth. Yes, you heard that right. 3 frets should sound like this. Which, in vibrato terms, would sound like this. Now, the only real way to achieve this is by engaging the muscles of your forearm in the left hand and giving it a really good solid shake. With a pinched harmonic, it should sound like this. Which is really just kind of one of those signature sounds that you hear Zakk do all of the time. It's that low E string pinched harmonic. We're also applying a little bit of vibrato on the 10th fret when we get to the kind of the midway point of this riff. And we're re-picking that with a bit of a semi-harmonic, which is kind of a pinched harmonic, only not all the way. And you really just have to experiment with this until you can find a nice kind of semi-harmonic blend, which we will need in just a moment. Now, the first lead guitar lick we have is kind of an exchange bend, which is sort of Hendrix-inspired. We're kicking our chorus on for this bit, because it's taking us into our Black Label-inspired riff, which I'll show you in a second. It sounds like this. And the way we get that is by playing a unison bend on our 10th fret. We're in the key of D, so we're going to be based around our D minor pentatonic first position. We play a unison bend on the E and B strings using fingers 1 and 3. Finger 2 is supporting, but as we bend the B string up, we're going to catch the G string and start to bend that as well. We'll bend up on the B and E strings like this. But we're not going to let it come down. We're going to catch our middle finger on the B string and the E string, we'll pick that and let those two come down. And then together we get this. And then to finish things off, double stop, and then a single note on G fret number 12. And if you can get a pinched harmonic to come out on that one, even better. It should sound like this. And that takes us into our Black Label-inspired riff, which involves some semi-harmonics down the low E string. The riff sounds like this. Now, the way we're achieving that semi-harmonic effect is, once again, by kind of playing with this thumb and index finger brush, and we're moving the picking assembly from kind of close to the bridge to a little closer to the neck, and you'll hear that kind of harmonic layer on the low E string descending through this kind of major seven, or rather dominant seven kind of sound. It'd be a bit like if it went like this. But we get it like this. Which is really quite good fun. We have a big Jimi Hendrix style D7 sharp 9 chord, and we're gonna give that a big vibrato. Again, you have to use the muscles of your left arm to carry this off, because if you try and do it with your fingers, it's not gonna work. It's just gonna sound a bit insipid. So make sure you get the whole arm involved in that, and if you have to shake the neck of the guitar, that's totally fine. Should sound like this. And the bit that follows immediately on from this, this will only work if you have a guitar with a tunematic style bridge, is this little rick across the strings behind the bridge. However, if you have a guitar that doesn't have a tunematic style bridge, you can actually hold down a harmonic, which is just past the second fret, and get a similar kind of effect. So you could go like this. It's not quite the same, but it's close enough. And of course, in the second time through this, we've got those pinched harmonics like this. Down on our third fret. And once again, that is with that massive wide vibrato. So make sure your whole arm's involved in executing that. One more time, the riff sounds like this. So moving swiftly into our first solo, this is inspired by Zakk's, again, 2000s work with Ozzy, and it's kind of very indicative of the way that he plays when he's soloing under the watchful eye of the boss. It's basically, it's very organized, it's very in time, and it's a lot stricter than people have kind of come to expect from Zakk in more recent years. We will explore the more reckless side of his playing in just a moment, but we're going to begin with a D minor pentatonic picked run, and this is kind of where we start with our downward pick slanting thing, and this is kind of where it's really important. We're doing two notes on every string, and it's going to be down and up. And the way we're going to play this is in groups of ascending sixes. We'll start on fret 10 and 12 from the A string down to the G string, like this. And once we have that, we're going to backtrack one string up, and we'll play again 10, 12, 10, 12, and we'll move out to 10 and 13 on the B string, like this. And now that we're here, we're going to backtrack one more, but we'll change the G fret 12 for a G fret 13, which will give us this. Except we're not going to catch that high string, we'll just get this. And all together we have, which takes us straight into some swooping high bends. I'm going to turn my chorus off for this one, and we get that unison bend, an exchange kind of bend from before, except we're going to kind of like eat out on it a little bit more, which will give us this. So once again, it's that big sweeping unison bend. We're going to be quick on the bend up, and we're going to release very slowly to create this kind of like swooping sort of effect. And then once again, we have kind of a double stop bend on the G and B string, releasing to a double stop on fret 10, and then fret 12 to finish like this. And from here, we move into a descending version of our ascending pentatonic run from before. Again, in groups of three strings, we get this kind of effect. And this is once again making use of that fret 13, that flat 5 note on the G string. So we get a group of three strings on 13 and 10. Then we have 13, 10, 13, 10, 12, 10. And from here, we're moving into a chicken picking kind of lick, which we'll see again later on in our second solo, or rather our fourth solo. The chicken picking lick is going to go like this. So we'll begin that with a pull-off, which is gonna give us time to kind of get in place to use our middle two fingers from the right hand to pluck the G and B strings. The pull-off is gonna be from 12 to 10 on the D string. And from here, we play 12 and 12 on the G string and the D string using middle finger and then pick. And this is where we start to throw those double stops in. We're gonna play a double stop on 10 and 10 with a hammer on from G10 to G11, and then we'll pull back off. Just like that. And we have another pull off down at the bottom from D12 to D10. So that lick together sounds like this. We play it two times at kind of a fairly rapid tempo to get this kind of like this chicken picking sort of sound. And we'll finish it with some heavy vibrato on G12 once again. We're really kind of like spending a lot of time on that note, but it does sound very characteristically Zakk. I think it sounds great. So let's move on to our next passage, which is gonna be this four note kind of repeated, I suppose you might call it economy picking group, that we're gonna see quite a lot of as we go further forward. It's gonna sound like this. Now what we have going on there is on our B string, we have either fret 10 and 13 or fret 10 and 15. And we also have this 13th fret note using the middle finger on the G string. And we begin with the middle finger, but our focus is gonna be the highest note on the B string, which I'll get to in a second. So we'll begin, like I say, with the middle finger note, we'll play down and then we'll sweep through onto the B string like this. Once we've done that, we're gonna play an upstroke, and this will be kind of where we focus our attention. The upstroke on the highest note on the B string, followed by a pull off, and that kind of completes the cycle. So what we get is this. And we're gonna alternate whether we're playing 13 or 15 as the highest note on the B string, and it'll give us this kind of thing. And that's kind of that four note rudiment that we're gonna revisit a few times as we go through this piece. Once we've done that, we have a slightly more kind of like free time idea. I've notated this in quintuplets, which is five notes to a beat. You don't need to stay too strictly to that. Just try and get as many of the notes in as you can before we move on to our kind of like pseudo whammy effect that we'll get to in a second. This is gonna be, again, downward pick slanting. We'll play 13-10 on the B string, followed by 13-10, 15-10, 13-10 on the high E string and also the B string. And this will give us fingers 3-1, 4-1, 3-1, and we'll get this kind of effect. Followed by 13-10, 13-10, 13-10 on G, B, G, like this. And again, just get as much of that in as you can before we start doing the kind of slightly silly lick which comes next. It should sound like this all together. And as you'll notice, that falls really neatly into our strict downward pick slanting kind of approach with this one, because every string change is after an upstroke. So it's surprisingly efficient, especially when you're using Zakk's elbow-driven technique. Now, once we have this, we're gonna do a pseudo whammy type effect, which is gonna sound like this. Now, this is a pretty flashy technique. It looks quite cool. It is a bit daft. We like a bit of that sort of thing. What we're doing is we're using the right hand to kind of fret behind the left hand. Best way to get into this is to slide your left hand up just to a random part of the fretboard somewhere up here. We're not aiming for a particular musical result with this one. It's just sort of a noise. So it doesn't really matter where you go as long as it's higher than your right hand. The right hand is going to come across and fret the G string. And both hands are gonna kind of slide in this direction at roughly the same pace. Don't sweat it if you don't get them at exactly the same distance. It really doesn't matter. And we're gonna hammer on and pull off with the index finger of our left hand, all the while using the flesh of the right hand middle finger to mute the D string and A string, which is gonna stop things from being too noisy. It should, fairly slowly, sound something like this. Sounds a bit daft slow, but when you speed it up, it sounds great. And this was kind of born of a few things. First of all, Zach's a big Randy Rhoads fan, and this is the sort of thing that Randy would do to kind of simulate having a whammy bar on a guitar that didn't have one, such as a Les Paul. And of course, Zach has kind of followed in that tradition to kind of get a bit of that 80s flash going on in there. Once we have that, we're going to very, very quickly kick our chorus off, and sorry, rather kick our chorus on and our overdrive off as we move into our Black Label inspired ballad. Starts with this chord progression, sounds like this. So what we have going on with this one, very, very quickly, is a D minor. You might think of it as an A-shaped D minor bar chord, but we're going to leave the high E string ringing open, which will give us this kind of D minor 9 kind of sound, which will give us this. And I'm achieving that with a sweep. You can pick this if you want, or you can play individual downstrokes, whatever works for you. I just find the sweep a little bit more reliable, personally. We're going to move to a C add 9. G over B, and then we'll play a B flat, again based on an A shape, but we're going to leave the high E string ringing to introduce the sharp 11, like this. And one more time, that progression together sounds like this.